170 na po ang COVID-19.
Clear, the global pandemic is taking a devastating toll on the economy.
Over $2.4 trillion has been wiped out.
Italy went down, tried to raise the alarm about a new mystery virus.
Has reported a 50% rise in the number of people who died of COVID-19.
At umabot na po ang kaso natin sa 8,772.
Limang na repatriate na OFW ang kabilang sa mga bagong tinamaan ng COVID-19 sa Cebu City.
Result niyan will take again days.
More than 1 million in the nation have been confirmed infected with coronavirus.
Concerns that as many as 1 in 50 people may be infected.
President Donald Trump is reportedly looking for ways to retaliate against Beijing.
Overall, 186,599 people have tested positive.
They could have stopped it, but they didn't. It's something that is going to have to be dealt with.
I might declare martial law, and there will be no turning back.
Indeed, we are witnessing a very dark time in history where countless lives are being lost, where many businesses are going bankrupt, where the government is losing control, where people are losing their minds over this quarantine season, and it looks so bad that things are just plummeting into stone. It's just rumors of war, there's earthquakes, you know, everything's just crazy. Indeed, things are not getting better. Things are just getting worse. Every single day, there's more deaths than the last time. Now, what's the point of me saying all of this? What's the point of stating the obvious already? Well, if you're a disciple of Christ, I have an encouragement for all of you watching this. And it's a very simple sentence that I'm going to say, and that is, God is good. I want you to say that with me. God is good. Even if the world is falling apart, even if our businesses are going bankrupt, even if lives are being lost, God is still good. Even if the worst has happened and the worst is still happening and the worst is to come, He's still good. We may not understand the things that are happening, nor we may understand the things why they're happening. But I tell you this, there's a God above, His name is Jesus, and He is still good. Now indeed, we may blame God for people dying. We may say, God, why are people dying? Why are these crazy things that are driving the nations insane happening? Why? Well, I'll tell you something, there is a purpose. There is a purpose that will, in the end, glorify Him. We may not see it yet, but it's gonna glorify our God. It says in Revelation 22 verse 13, I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and last, the beginning and the end. So if our Creator, if our Author of life has written the end from the beginning, why should we fear? It's like having a book. You have already seen the ending many times, and you know that there's going to be conflict, there's going to be climaxes, there's going to be chaos. Why should you fear? Because you've seen the end. It's all part of God's story, and He wants us to understand that He's in control. He is God. He is the Lord of all. So fear not. Don't worry about what's going to happen. Trust God and put your faith in Him. Now, some of you may be asking, did God lose His control? Did God just create us human beings for us to fall into sin and to, you know, fall away, and now He can't control us? I don't think so. In fact, it says in Colossians 1 verse 16, for by Him all things were created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, or principalities, or powers. All things were created by Him and for Him. So we human beings, everything in this world, all angels, all demons, all spirits, were created by and for Him. You may also wonder, is God evil? Did God make this COVID thing happen? No. Hardly, not even close. In 1 John 1:15, it says, this is the message we have heard from Him, and we announce it to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness. It is our fallen nature that allows everything to go to chaos. Not God, no. And indeed, in Ephesians 6 verse 12, we wrestle not against flesh, but principalities and the higher beings of this world. And that is why we have these really weird things happening, because they're also involved. We have to remember that there's a spirit world as well that's involved in all of this. It's not just physical, but there are other spiritual beings too that are created from God. They're dangerous as well, so we need to be on guard. Now, what I'm trying to say is there's a plan. There's a plan for all of this. We can't understand. God is there. He's moving. We can't see it though. because he's God. And whenever you say, God, why'd you do this? Why did you make this happen? Why did people have to die? Well, Isaiah 40 verse 13 says, who can fathom the spirit of the Lord or instruct the Lord as his counselor? Who are we to tell God, don't do it this way, do it our way, do it the way we want? We're not God, we're just created human beings. And we're here to submit to God. Now, why am I saying this? Why am I giving this big point about God? Well, it's very simple. It's about productivity. I know this COVID has been a very tough time for all of us. All of us are just so caught up with our lives, with priorities, with our family, with things that matter at this moment. It's about time that we be productive and do things that actually matter. And the first is about being practical. Now, I have a friend who made this amazing video. It's going to be linked right over here. It's about how to be productive at a time like this. How to, you know, just create, learn a new skill, clean your house indeed, read a book, invest in the future, invest in things that matter, not in the temporary. Now, I'm not saying it's wrong to play video games. I'm not saying it's wrong at all to watch K-drama or Netflix. I'm not saying that at all. What I'm saying is that when our entire life revolves around those two, when we wake up, the first thing we do is just do that until the time we sleep at 4 a.m. or 5 a.m. That's bad, and it has to stop. It says in Proverbs 14 verse 23, and in all toil there is profit, but mere talk tends only to poverty. Indeed, when we create, when we invest in something, when we work, there's going to be something that's going to be reaped from it. If I just sit down and do things that don't matter, it won't help anyone. It really won't. The second one is about being economical. Now is a really good time to thank God for everything, for the Wi-Fi, for the electricity, for the water, for the food, for the shelter, for the community, for a safe environment, for our family, for our friends, for technology, for gadgets, for our material needs, you know? There are many people who are less fortunate, who have all this, and we complain about having no Wi-Fi. So I'm saying is we don't really understand the value of something unless we lose it. And that's when we see that, oh, we actually had that thing. Indeed, we should appreciate and praise God for all he has given us. For indeed, he is our Jehovah Jireh, our provider. In Matthew 6, 25 to 34, it says, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and body more than clothes? He's saying that there's more than to the physical body, to the physical realm around us. There's a spiritual realm. Matthew also talks about storing our treasures in heaven. There's more to life than what's on earth, and it's good we invest in the things that are in heaven. Now this leads me to my final point, and again, I know all of you are busy with your lives. You have your family to attend to, your physical needs, I do too. But I encourage everyone, do not neglect God during this quarantine season. If we don't even see God during this quarantine, what more if this quarantine ended? What more if there wasn't even a quarantine to begin with? And there'd be nothing to push us to love God, to seek Him. But now we've been enclosed to the very space of our homes, and yet we still don't seek God sometimes. So I encourage everyone, this is the best time, this is the perfect time where you should be seeking God. Indeed, we need to repent and change our mindset and things. We need to stop our addictions. Now I'm not saying again, it's bad to watch movies on Netflix or do gaming. It's bad when it becomes your life. There's so much more to life than all these things. These are just small blessings, you know, times we can just sit down and just relax and let the stress go away. But when it becomes a lifestyle, that's where it becomes really bad. In Matthew 6:33, it says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Seek God and his righteousness. Be holy, for I am holy. It says in 1 Peter, we are to walk in his footsteps, to go the path that he went. Now I'll tell you something that Jesus did. He prayed. He prayed a lot. He prayed and prayed and prayed. In fact, it says in 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 to 18, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and give thanks in all circumstances. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Now, this is the best time to just get on your knees, morning, lunch, get on your knees and just dedicate a word of prayer, because your prayer is so powerful. It shakes the spiritual realm. Another reminder I want to give everyone is to renew your mind. In Romans 12, 2 talks about the constant renewing of the mind. Do not be conformed to the ways of this world. The world wants you to enjoy, to have the pleasure, to enjoy all these small pleasures. Again, they're called small pleasures because they're meant to be enjoyed in small bites. But when you take it as a giant whole, you're doing every single day of your life, that's where it's gotta stop. Because God wants us to fix our eyes on the kingdom that is coming. Fix our eyes on Him, not on the small pleasures of this world. Another one is to be sober. 1 Peter 5 verse 8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour." So I'm saying is that if you're not on your toes, if you're not on your guard, he's gonna come after you and he's gonna take advantage of whatever it is. There's many ways he can do it. He can do it through the smallest things. And then he can do it through what we love. And he can make that as a stronghold, a foothold for him to take advantage of you. Don't waste your time. Spend your time reading the Word of God. If you see that dusty old book on your shelf that says Holy Bible, you take it out and you pat the dust off and you start reading it. For the Bible is not just some book with black text and paper. It's living, it's the living Word of God. It's spirit and truth. When you read it, it fills you up with knowledge and insight. It feeds your spirit, for man must not live on bread alone, but every word that comes out of the Word of God. It's there to edify, it's there to help you, to guide you, to know what God wants, to know what God wants for you. It's His will written in that book. The children of God, those who are in His kingdom, everyone has a purpose, everyone has a calling. We just gotta seek it. We gotta pray every day, "Lord, what do you want to do with me? Let your Holy Spirit guide me and let me be used. Let me be effective in this." It says in Philippians 1 verse 6, "Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it out onto completion until the day of Christ Jesus." So if you're not dead, then he's not done. He's got a plan for you. Now it's up to us, it's our free will to say, "Okay, God, I'm gonna let you use me. I humble myself and God, use me effectively." Now, what I'm saying is your calling should never supersede the calling of the Holy Spirit, the calling of God in your life. If you were called to be a musician, a lawyer, business owner, an IT person, a doctor, or a chef, whatever calling is on earth, it should never supersede the calling of God in your life. It needs to be first. In fact, where your calling on this earth can be a place where you can be effective. Now, if you claim to be a disciple of Christ and you want to seek Him and obey Him, I encourage you to do the things that He has commanded us to do. And it says in the Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, the recurring theme is to make disciples, to baptize Him in the name of the Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus, to heal the sick, to cast out demons, to pray for people. He's given us the authority to do these things through the Holy Spirit and only through the Holy Spirit. We can't do these things with our own works, through our own works. This task, go on healing the sick, go on praying for people, go on believing. It's a present continuous tense. We have to continue to do it because that's our life. That's as a believer of Christ, as a disciple of Christ, that's what we're called to do. This is the life we're going to live. There's a King who's coming back. And when He comes back, He will be clouded in glory. He'll be clouded in light. And every heart needs to be ready to receive Him. And I speak to you. He's coming soon and we need to prepare our hearts. It says here in Matthew 24 verse 44, "The Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect Him." He's coming at a time where we're so caught up with academics, caught up with work, our family, perhaps. It says in Philippians 3:20, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly await our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." He's coming back. We gotta ready our hearts. We gotta be ready for His coming. Because when He comes, He's not coming to be crucified. He's going to come to fight and to judge. And we need to be ready for that. Indeed, we must get ready for His return. And we need to say with all our hearts, "Father God, come quicker, for we eagerly await You." The kingdom of God is coming. And it's going to come sooner than we expect. So be ready. Thank you for watching. God bless. I'll see you in the next video.